Greetings, Guardians. My name is Byfear. So there's a whole ton left to be talked about thanks to yesterday. The Witch Queen reveal is honestly one of the biggest things we've seen in Destiny's near decade-long history as far as reveal streams go, and there are some burning questions left over from the reveal. Before we say anything more, quick note, by the way, if somehow you are staying under a rock, spoilers, not like leaks, but spoilers from the reveal, so if you want to go ahead and watch the reveal. It's about an hour and 40 minutes, so you should go ahead and start that and come back to this video afterwards. Anyway, some big questions left over from the reveal. Why is there a pyramid ship smack bang in the middle of Savathun's Ascendant Realm? How is the Season of Lost going to prime us for the Witch Queen expansion? And how long has Savathun been plotting this masterstroke of hers? But unquestionably, the most asked and biggest questions of them all revolve around the Lucent Brood and Savathun's newfound power to steal and manipulate the light. How was Savathun able to accomplish this? What are the wider implications for all of this? And could we have predicted this from the beginning? Let's go ahead and try and answer some of those last three questions. First of all, let's start with the how. How was Savathun able to accomplish this? And honestly, at this moment, we're not sure at all, but I believe this is going to be the question that inevitably is answered as a part of the conclusion of the current season, aka the Season of the Lost. Savathun is cunning and capable of an incredible amount of insight, so it's not impossible that over her time, somehow, she cracked the code or secret to manipulating the light into gifting certain individuals with its gifts. However, the Traveler is supposedly the one that released all the ghosts, and so it really raises a huge number of questions if somehow these ghosts were maybe stolen away or corrupted, if they were tampered with somehow, or if, Lord forbid, the Traveler released new ghosts, or perhaps if these ghosts simply became corrupted by the Hive of their own will. We know that ghosts can indeed fall to darkness. We've seen it with ghosts that belong to characters such as Toland the Shattered, who endorsed his explorations into darkness. However, Ikora provides in the trailer perhaps the most direct answer to our question, although granted it may simply be based on her own perspective of the matter. Ikora in the gameplay trailer for Witch Queen states that Savathun, quote, stole the light, which could lead us to some truly fascinating places and conclusions. I mean, last season, under the guise of Osiris, Savathun literally asked for the light-suppressing device used by the Scions to nearly assassinate Commander Zavala. So we're not in a place where such thievery is impossible by Savathun. And if Savathun has picked up this tech, it seems fairly possible that she would be able to reverse engineer it, just based purely on the Hive's greater knowledge of, well, the universe and everything to do with it. I do, however, doubt that such tech would even be a path to the Light's power, and the reason I say that is because of Dominus Gaul and the comparison one can draw between his scenario and this one. The closest comparison, of course, does lie with Gaul and his attempt to steal the Light, but the methods by which he did so were much more forced and imperfect. The Light burned him up and consumed him, ultimately rejecting and destroying him. Savathun's Lucent Brood have achieved the same heights as Gaul by manifesting the Light's powers and supers, but he never had a ghost, and was never capable of the same feat of resurrection that both Guardians and the Hive of the Lucent Brood are now capable of. This is a whole other ballgame, and it almost makes me wonder if there is a more elegant solution and reason why the Lucent Brood have been able to attain the Light like this. The main promotional site for Witch Queen, as attached to Bungie.net, gives us a little more information on the Lucent Brood as well, and gives us this little note. Savathun has gifted her soldiers with the powers of the light. As the knight you've struck down rises from the dead for the second time, a feeling of betrayal washes over you, and you can't help but wonder, when the light offers no shelter, no solace, where will you turn? Not only does this show that Savathun has been able to gift the light to her troops, but it also leaves us with a terrifying question which gets us onto our second big real topic of discussion here, which is what are the wider implications for the existence of Hive Lightbearers? I think that this hints to something really important, which is that the moral greyness of Destiny's universe is about to become all the more grey. regardless of whether the light was stolen or, Lord forbid, even directly gifted to Savathun somehow, and her brood, the light is now a force that can be used by forces that are objectively both evil and good, just as darkness can be used by forces that are evil and good. Unquestionably, one, aka the light, trends to the moral direction that would save us and would be considered good, and the other, the darkness, trends towards almost a moral fascism. But it leaves us still in a place where the Hive, the brutal genocidal monsters that they are now capable of using the light, which has been the giver of life and the antithesis of their entire philosophy. Just in the same way that we Guardians have been able to wield the power of stasis in spite of our constant, valorous cries as we defend the last city of humanity. Destiny's universe is now a place where we're able to ask ourselves the truly great questions, such as whether the light is truly good or whether the darkness is truly evil, or whether one can even view them through such simple lenses that are, admittedly, marred by human perspective. We now have to look deep into understanding the nature of the darkness and the light to gauge whether their visions for the universe are what we truly wish to follow. Knowing that the darkness has created monsters such as Oryx, and that the light has potentially empowered monsters such as Savathun. Either way, Destiny's universe has just gotten a whole lot more complicated, and honestly, that is probably for the better. With the crowning chapters of the Light and Dark saga coming to a close, I think it's appropriate that we should really start to think about the nature of the world in which we're living, and get to the core of the biggest question. In the next 3 years, we may be on the cusp of answering the biggest questions about the universe of Destiny that we've ever seen. What is inside the Traveler? What is the nature of the power of these two paracausal beings, the Gardener and the Winnower? Is what we read in the Unveiling lore book all those years ago true? All these questions and more may be answered in the coming years. I think the final thing to ask is whether we could have possibly predicted that this story would be possible. I think, funnily enough, ever since her arrival in Destiny 2, there's always been an indication that things were going in this direction. It was just so utterly unimaginable that it was impossible for us to see it. We start by looking at our very first encounter with Savathun, which was on Io, a place brimming with light, where she would not only build an army of Taken using her various methods, but would also attempt to access the Vex information in the Pyramidion in the Festering Core Strike years later. In the process of all this, she was probably able to discover at least a little information on the Light, given the Vex and their position on Io. Savathun's forces on Titan were capturing Guardians and harvesting their Void Light to weave their dark magics and summon a Great Shrieker to Titan, which Savathun was undoubtedly going to use to watch over that world. But the channeling off of the light here in the first place may have given Savathun some inspiration, but there are other places in which Savathun's designs are further revealed. There's a conversation in particular that I want to highlight, one that comes from Savathun's perspective, and one that is conducted back in the days of Shadowkeep. It is between her and the sword logic purist Hive known as Malkanth, who saw the broods that previously had been under Crota's command grow weak under the command of his children, such as Besurith and Hashladun. Malkanth was slaughtered thanks to Savathun's trickery and her willingness to conduct certain plans that allowed her to accomplish her own ends at the expense of the brood. This also was something that allowed her to sit and speak, if only briefly, with Malkanth, and this conversation, which is conducted within the Inquisition of the Damned lore book, is actually one of the most revealing conversations as to Savathun's plans. It reads as follows. No gods, only devils. Malkanth feels herself slide free from her body. The exorcism is sudden and effortless. Then come the whispers. I stoked your brother's fire, riled him that he might strike. I needed only the wound to tear you free. The piercing of your heart will take some mending, but your vessel is fit for what is to come. I know this comes as a shock, but trust that my actions were such that you felt only the briefest pain as the edge broke through. And now, this. Now, peace. I asked not for peace, O hidden sister of shapes. You know this voice. I know you have many. I have heard their faint temptations since I was a child. Never have I sought their counsel. You have asked for nothing, this is true. You sought only to take. You are a willful, treacherous thing. I quite like you. Make no mistake, I see no fault in your desires, nor the attempt to see them realized. Your only sin in the eyes of those who matter was that you were not yet positioned to achieve the full extent of your potential. You saw a moment, and you moved to act, like countless others before you. But your action was not enough. Worse, it was limited in its view of the power hidden so plainly within your grasp. Akrazul is a force worthy of change. His fury will be of little consequence. Kill the ineffectual priests, murder the daughters of a failed prince, sully the sword logic and crown a new ruler. Still, the swarm will be nothing more than a faint flicker when the time comes for the cosmos and all its intentions to be weighed and judged by those who sit on thrones beyond our imagination. My path, the sacrifice made here, will serve to carve my intentions upon concerns more immediate than those that await at the end of all things. Then we agree. My dismissal of the swarm's legacy is not a plea for you to consider gods wholly removed from the here and now. Quite the opposite. The dragon and the worm, the larva and the queen, the peasant and the god. So many deities, so many rules. There are endless myths etched into the plague called life. They are not hope or promise or power. They are exaggerations born of misunderstandings. Yet they govern so much. Your actions and mine, day to day, cycle to cycle, evolution to evolution. Always idols to guide and punish and love and destroy. But are any true? Whom must we placate with worship and reverence, with offerings and sacrifice, with praise as armor for their frail egos? The truth is, dear child, there are no gods, only absolutes. Yet here we sit, on the edge of the greatest unmaking. Time is no longer time when radiolaria dance upon history gone and yet to be. Space is no longer space when we have torn reality to carve out our own secret planes of being. Death is no longer death when the champions of the light rise and fall, never backing down, never truly knowing defeat. All that remains is ignorance, the last absolute, the final, unassailable truth. Time can be bent and broken, redirected to the whims of those with the knowledge and the will. Space can be shredded asunder, excavated to discover new and ancient realms not chained to understanding. Death can be ignored through impossible energies and advanced technologies, both physical and indistinguishable from magic. One can learn more, but none can learn all. What then? When immortality and the totality of space and time can be joined to learn the last of the unknowns. When the final absolute falls, reality will shudder and blink, and a new absolute will emerge. An ending, total and complete. You wish to see that end? I wish to ensure it does not come to pass. Will you take me with you?
I had considered such a thing, but no.
Your purpose is served. How so, if I have failed?
You have failed in furthering your own goals, poor thing.
Not mine. Malkanth considers these words and is overcome with a sudden, final sense of dread as she feels her essence fade to nothingness. Her last thought is of her sister. Savathun's plan here involving the light and its impossible mechanics is somewhat noted and touched on, given that it is one of the means by which the powers of the universe are bent and broken, as she notes in her perspective. But she also hints a little further as to what her endgame really was. Savathun perhaps wishes to become one with the constant of ignorance, to become one with it in a similar manner perhaps to Oryx's eventual plans of ascension, where he too might become an axiom. Savathun states that all of this is a means to prevent the great unmaking and cataclysm of the universe that will create an end, total and absolute. What this ending, this cataclysm might be, well, we can only guess. But at the same time, I feel as though on the horizon, something named the Final Shape might provide us the answer. Finally, we also need to pay attention to Savathun's words within the last city, where she observed the power of the ghosts, the Traveler's Light, the abilities of the Guardians, and how she was growing weaker at the hands of her worm. All of these took place within the Hawkmoon and Retro-Futurist lore tabs, as well as the Ripe lore entry from the Beneath the Endless Night lore books. They demonstrate that under the guise of Osiris, Savathun's intent has been clear enough for us to see if we had the inspiration and imagination to envision it. Constantly, there was the looking up at the Traveler, the observation of the ghosts and their power, of the light and the abilities that Guardians were able to wield with it, and of the indomitable spirit that they bore out as they wielded such power. Ultimately then, I suppose if you had enough inspiration, you would have been able to see that Savathun was indeed intending to take the light for quite some time. As Ikora notes in the gameplay trailer, she went into hiding after her brother's death, his death being the proof absolute, for her at least, that the darkness was in fact not the way to survive, and that such things could be challenged. As a result, the Witch Queen will not be unprepared for anything that is thrown her way. She will not take anything lightly, and she will make sure that whatever action she takes, it is measured and calculated with the precision of a being that has existed for millennia upon millennia, who knows the very dynamics of the universe itself, and who understands how to tip the balance of a person simply through a moment of raw influence. This is Savathun's truth. Her trickery, her penchant for being able to deceive us has always been her strongest suit. But now, I feel as though we need to understand and maybe wonder that she would perhaps not enact this plan unless she needed to. If there is one more thing we can truthfully believe, it's that the Witch Queen was indeed preparing for something. She would have no reason to lie to one such as Malkanth, whose existence was about to be snuffed out. She would have no reason to do so whatsoever. Having said all of that, such things as involving Savathun are never quite as simple as they appear. And I think if there's one thing that we can all judge and we can all understand, it's simply this. Treat her with the same caution that you always have. Do not allow her honeyed words to be masked as anything other than the foul poison that they are. She is indeed trying to sway us to her side even in this moment, even as our reality starts to bend in around us. This is indeed the dangerous moment, where Savathun is able to do, with a degree of safety, what she is best at doing, conducting her plans, manipulating others, and using trickery to get what she wants. Beware of the Witch Queen. She is now perhaps more powerful than she has ever been. But that's all from me for now. If you enjoyed this video and if you want more like it on the lead up to Witch Queen, go ahead and leave a like and let me know your own thoughts in the comments section down below. Of course, if you want more content like this, you can also hit subscribe and you can hit the bell next to subscribe to stay tuned with those email notifications. But of course, know that your viewership, as always, is quite enough for me. And that in the meantime, my name has been My Name is Bife. Kurodasia Ad Astra. I'll see you, Starside.